And then David, scoot over.
Are you okay with the light?
Yeah, no, I just accidentally stared.
Ideally, you're...
You can check yourself out.
I know.
The quality room.
You know, it's funny you ask that. I'm sorry, I'm just distracted. I'm happiest when there are no mirrors. Generally, it's a good solution. I don't have a mirror over my bathroom sink. Life changer.
How do you do that?
Well, you move in and they don't have one, and you don't make a stink about it, and you don't want to buy it yourself, so.
So you don't apply makeup, or you?
I have a mirror in my house. I just don't, you know, it's just that first thing in the morning when you go to brush your teeth, you don't have to be confronted with. And it's a scary moment, isn't it?
I'm old enough to have stopped looking, I think.
It's the same yeah. Idea. Yeah.
I just don't, it's weird.
Don't look.
I sometimes wonder how I managed to get out of the bathroom in the morning without my hair doing whatever it was doing that day.
But, mm-hmm.
And my wife has now stopped telling me.
Oh.
So sometimes we'll actually walk out of the house and she goes, "What with your hair?" I'm like, "Honey, that's your job is to tell me I look like an idiot."
What is it? It's a Velvet Underground song, right? I'll be your mirror.
Yes. It's a lovely thing. Of course, my son likes it.
It can go either way. Having a mirror, a human mirror. Anyway.
So the basic idea of this is to chat about human mirrors and other things.
Excellent.
Feel free to wander. Feel free to curse. We run it uncut. You can curse only if you want. You don't have to curse.
But I will.
You're a big curser.
But I'm allowed to curse.
You are more than allowed to curse. You're welcome to curse.
Now I probably won't. I don't know.
We scared it out of you by offering you the opportunity.
Well, you know, it's just, you know, it's like, it's always when you make an ass of yourself, you know what I mean? Like, if I'm allowed to, I probably won't get into that particular kind of trouble. Anyway, I don't know what I'm talking about. Yeah, okay.
Okay. So, did you just wander into Paul's life? Did you know Paul before all of this, or?
No, yeah, neither, I would say. I probably would have tried to wander into his life if I knew where he lived or something, but no, I had to do a movie, and it had to come out and then go onto cable channels and then appear in the middle of the night one night, and then he had to happen to be flipping through.
So he found you on TV
a particular evening.
The
yep. Mm-hmm.
Which movie?
It's called The Babysitters. I play a teenage madam. And
so typecasting.
Exactly, I know. It's embarrassing fact of my past I don't like to talk about too much. No, but I'm not talking about Jesus. Never mind. Yeah, so he saw it. He called. He called or texted his casting director, longtime casting director Cassandra Koulikoundis. Said, "Hey, I found this broad. I think she's all right," something like that. I'm sure he didn't use the word broad. I think her response was, "Yeah, I've been telling you about this girl for a long time." She had seen me in plays in New York and stuff. So I heard about that before The Master came out, and it was sort of my it was my little secret for myself, you know, on rainy days in New York or bad days when I didn't get a job or something. I had this little morsel of information that kind of kept me going, that on some alternate universe, this director that I love so much knew that I existed, you know, and I kind of thought that's all it was ever going to be, just this kind of really welcomed bit of encouragement, you know. I never imagined I'd work with him.
So, what is it like starting a career? I mean, you're 5'11", right? Something like that. Even taller?
I think so.
Secretly taller.
On a good day, you know, after some stretches in the morning.
Two Tom Cruises. That's not nice, but...
well, no.
But I mean, so obviously you have some background in the show business from your family.
Yeah, I've been at it a while. Oh, yeah, you mean
so was it,
the
was
old nepotism.
It, yes, birthed into show business.
Mm.
But I mean, was there a sense of acting being an inevitability? Was there a sense of it being something you wanted to do from a little kid, or?
Yeah, I wanted to do it since I was a little kid. But, you know, I think a lot of little kids think that they're going to be performers when they grow up, you know. So I don't know. I guess I just didn't. I guess a lot of other kids get a better idea along the way, and I couldn't shake it. But I don't know that that was at all influenced by being around it, because I don't know any other way. Mm-hmm. I don't have any other childhood to compare it to. So certainly I saw my dad having a good time at work. I'm sure that made it appealing to me on some level. But it always felt like a pretty individual desire of mine, you know.
So was becoming a professional surprising? Was it what you expected? You were enjoying the thought about the babysitters a moment ago. Was becoming a professional actress what you expected?
Well, you mean as a child?
No, as you got older and you started to take it seriously.
Well, damn, of course, you know, when you start pursuing it, you hope that you get to be a professional actor since it's, you know, the job you want. I mean, I guess whatever you know, if you study law, you hope to become a lawyer, don't you? You know, I mean, it's the same thing. I definitely didn't want to sit at home knitting.
But is the work what you expected it to be? Is this whole thing of wondering whether you're going to get past the babysitters and do things that are more fulfilling?
Actually, the babysitters was a very fulfilling work experience, and I had a lot of really fulfilling work experiences that nobody really saw, you know. Honestly, I think I was too distracted over the years trying to get work to really scheme too much about the kind of career I wanted to have. I mean, of course, we all have hopes and dreams, and you know, you want to work with great directors, and sometimes they're not within reach. But I never really, all I ever wanted was to work with great directors and work on great parts. I never really thought about achieving some kind of notoriety or fame. I was probably just too distracted by the fear of when the next job was coming to think about that too much.
Has that changed?
No. Still just freaked out about what the next job is going to be.
Because you're pretty busy.
Apparently that never goes away, which is a disappointing truth.
So
I've
how did
heard
you find
stories
it?
From like old, you know, old fogies in the business.
Yeah.
Still paranoid about that same thing. You know, because we are beggars.
Do you see it that way?
Yeah. I mean, well, we can't make movies ourselves. Actors, you know what I mean? You rely on other people choosing you. It's tricky.
It's tricky. It stays tricky.
I think it stays tricky. Yeah.
Does the New York LA thing, do you spend a lot of time in LA, or are you based in LA now?
No, I live in New York.
You live in New York.
I spend a good amount of time out here, yeah.
Do you come out for pilot season, or do you just come out for specific jobs, or?
Yeah, sure. I mean, it's pilot season comes at the most perfect time of year to leave New York, you know, in January and February. So I've definitely done that. I two of my earliest jobs in the business were pilots. Mm-hmm. And they were great fun. They were like three camera sitcoms, and neither of them got picked up. And on the second one, I met some actors who'd been at it a long time doing shows that never got picked up, and I went back to New York and did theater for a couple of years, or more than a couple of years. Because I just didn't want that to be, I was afraid that that could be my life, and I didn't want to sit around all year and do a job for a couple of weeks, you know?
Hmm.
So I chose a $200 paycheck in New York instead for a while. Mm-hmm.
And would that have been, I guess, a good life for you in your mind? A life in theater would have been okay?
If they could just pay New York actors a little bit more, it's a fantastic life. The work is the best. I think that there's loads of actors who would be perfectly happy to never do a film. But you can't survive.
Yeah.
You simply can't. Not anymore. I worked with an actress who said that her paychecks in the theater haven't gone up since the 70s, despite inflation.
Mm.
I mean, that's insane. Plus, the rents just keep going up, up, up. So you basically can barely manage it.
Well, I guess it's where they built that building on 43rd Street, I think it is.
Oh, yeah. That's a bit crowded, though, isn't it?
Yeah, it's hard to get in there.
you have to wait for people to die. Yeah, you're going to poison old ladies or something to get in there.
Hey. So how did you finally actually meet Paul after hearing, I guess you heard the story in retrospect about the TV show?
Yeah,
the TV viewer.
No, I heard it at the time. That's what got me through like the last few years of feeling depressed and hopeless when people didn't hire me for things, you know. I heard about that before The Master. I think Cassandra, the casting director, told me because she knew I needed a little bit of hope, a little bit of encouragement.
Casting directors are kind of like the underpraised group.
Yeah, they're like fairy godmothers, so they can be.
Because you can really tell, like, you can see certain careers that kind of happen because one or two casting directors decided that somebody really deserves shots, and you kind of see shot after shot, you know, sometimes not on shows that are not successful.
Yeah.
But they keep on giving a chance.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I feel pretty indebted to Cassandra. She put me on tape for this. She believed in me for it. She doesn't give a damn about, you know, who's the hottest kid in town, and, you know, she doesn't, you know, I think she and Paul share that. They want to find the person they think is most right for the part. They don't care if somebody's agent is calling saying, you know, this so-and-so had their breakout role and it was at Sundance this year and all that crap. You know, they march the beat of their own drums. And, you know, it's march the beat of your own drummer, and it never made sense to me. I really think it should be drums. You've got the drumsticks in your hand. Wouldn't you be marching to the, you've got your own private drummer? What scenario is this? You've got your own private drummer who's walking around with you? It makes no sense to me.
It probably comes from some wealthy person who could afford to have a drummer behind them.
I'm gonna find out the etymology behind that one.
I always wanted to have somebody near me just to do rim shots.
I think it would be really annoying to have your own personal drummer getting you marching every morning. It seems sort of stressful.
And not looking in the mirror, and then, you know. So far, the whole morning analogy for you. Do you like morning?
You want to have your own drum, is what I'm saying. Don't you want to set the beat?
You don't want some drummer sitting in your home waiting for you.
Exactly.
Do you like morning?
Yeah.
Okay. This is it's an odd line. I've never asked that question before, but.
Yeah, I like mornings.
Morning has come up a couple times in this.
Yeah, I think it's a good time of day for someone who's dependent on other people for an employment, you know? You know, it's like, what's gonna happen today? Maybe there's gonna be some good news.
Like you get up and get raring to go?
Yeah, yeah.
So when did you finally meet Paul?
Well, I made an audition tape with Cassandra in New York, and she took it out to LA with her, I think, just about the next day. And then I sort of got encouraging texts from the West Coast, you know, from her saying, hey, he saw it, so-and-so saw it, people liked it, they saw it, you know. And
So how do you do an audition tape for a role like this?
Well, he didn't blindly, I guess is the answer, because I hadn't read the book, I hadn't read the script, I hadn't seen the script, I hadn't seen the sides before I walked into the room. He was giving them out cold to the actresses he was reading. So I just read them once, thought this is going to be terrible, I don't know what the hell I'm doing. And Cassandra sort of explained the scene. Have you seen the movie?
Mm-hmm.
It was the first scene in the, you know, between me and Joaquin's character. And I just think I read it. And that was it. I mean, that's the thing too. I mean, you can prepare for things for weeks and everything. Sometimes the thing that makes you write for a part, you can't even really control. I don't know. They saw something in this cold read.
Did it feel close at all to what you ended up doing?
I don't know. I don't know what I did that day. You know, I never saw the audition tape or anything.
Mm.
And then I came out to LA, so I guess it was about around 2 weeks later. I was really broke. I couldn't get out there. My friend's hairdresser is also a flight attendant, and he got me on a free flight. I mean, I was really, because it was right after a pilot season where I hadn't gotten a job, and I was really biting my nails. And he flew me out here. I shacked up with friends, you know, and I went in and I just kind of hung around with Paul for a couple of days, which felt like a couple of years, and then he gave me the job.
Why a couple of years? Why?
Just because I was losing my mind. I thought I'd retire if he didn't give me the job. But once I read the script, once I read the book, I really was a goner, and I thought it would have been a really brutal recovery time if I hadn't gotten the job.
So what do you think he was doing with you for 2 days? For a couple of days?
God, I don't know.
Were you just, I mean, was he just
sure I wasn't crazy
taking in your presence?
Yeah,
or?
Who knows? Well, he was looking for whatever he was looking for, you know? I don't know what that was.
Huh.
I think, you know, he's a great listener, and he Jenna Malone said something about him in an interview, in a Q&A a couple days ago, that I thought was really on the money. She said he sees people, you know, he really has a gift for that, seeing what they're about, what they've got to give. And so maybe he was just seeing me.
So you did he tell you about the part?
Is that too witchy of an answer?
No, it's not witchy. Witchy or bitchy? I'm not sure.
Witchy. I don't know.
Like it's too
like
mysterious.
Like a new agey or something.
Well, but I think that's exactly what, I mean, I think that's true with actually most every, all casting, is that part of it is, for the film at least, is that you're, the essence of a person is very hard to not capture on film.
That's
you know,
right.
You can't really overcome it in some ways. It's the
that's right.
problem of film acting. So, I mean, unless you're completely a person who disappears in the character, which some people are, but that's not the role here.
But even then, it's the spirit of the person comes through.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's true. In one's eyes.
And if you don't know the person, and he knows a limited amount of your work, then I guess whatever he was looking for in your energy.
Yeah.
Which does sound new age, but
yeah,
it's true.
I guess this stuff ends up sounding kind of hippy dippy, even if you're not making a movie about 1970.
Well, the thing is, energy, I think, is such a critical thing with an actor, and that, you know, whether it's going to come through the camera is not always clear, but it's so much the core of the whole thing. I mean, if the energy is not being pushed out, you can't.
It's what you got.
You can't ever fix that.
Yeah.
And it's so different than theater. It's not. It's not the same energy at all. I don't think, or is it, for you?
I think it's the same. I've thought about this quite a bit, and I think it's really the same. But the work for me is the same. It's just, you know, maybe you have to move around in a slightly different way for it to reach the back row or something. Mm. But I don't know. The actors I like the most to watch on stage, I feel like, are the same kinds of actors that I like to watch the most on film. You know, they're the ones you can't turn away from.
Yeah.
And at home, you can just as easily go fiddle with your phone, and in the theater, you could think about where you're going to eat dinner later or something. You know, you can always find some way to distract yourself unless they grab you by the collar, you know. And the ones that do that for me are the ones that are the most present and most natural. And so I kind of feel like the work is the same in a way.
Mm. It's interesting. Because some people convert naturally and some people really don't. I mean, there are great stage actors who don't work on film, and there are great film actors who don't work on stage, and then there's some who do both brilliantly.
Yeah. I don't agree.
Really?
I've never seen someone that I love on stage that I haven't then loved in their film work. The ones that I think are too broad on film, I don't like on stage. They're phonies.
Well, that may be their thing.
Well, cast them as phonies then, and maybe I'll like it.
Well, I mean, they have the McNally revival right now of It's Only a Play, which
is
all about people playing big. You know, it's like that's part of the thing.
Right.
Not that those actors are not great actors, but, you know,
right.
Sometimes that's what's called for, I guess. Or that's your persona.
Yeah.
I mean, same thing with being a movie star. There are people who,
yeah,
they're always the movie star and not ever really acting, quote unquote.
That's right, that's right. So, although I don't know, I welcome some broadness in film too. Like, it's the thing I hear the most about, the comment I get the most from people who've only seen the trailer is Joaquin, after he gets, have you seen the trailer?
Mm-hmm.
The last shot is when he gets hit over the head, and then he's swinging to try to punch the guy before he gets knocked out. And it's really, it's a pretty big move, you know, and it's hilarious, and it seems really true to life. And there's a lot of big stuff in life, you know, so I don't know. I don't mind size.
Well, Joaquin definitely is a little Wile E. Coyote in this movie. He's
he's amazing. Yeah, oh, I just love that guy.
So you found out you got the role, finally.
Yes, after 3 years of
after
auditioning.
Torture. So at that point, you guys talk about it a lot, or is it on you to kind of do the work and bring it to them?
Yeah, I think it's on the actors. You know, certainly, I think, you know, no one else can do that, your job for you. And I think, you know, I think Paul really hopes and expects his actors to come in with an idea of what they're going to do, because he's got so many other jobs to think about.
So he's not big on conversing about it to the end of time.
I'm not sure what he's like with other people. For me, I didn't want to talk it to death, because I was playing a very secretive woman, and I wanted to feel that way as much as I could. Certainly, if I had a question, I didn't feel I couldn't ask him. Mm. But it made me feel better to keep things to myself. It made me feel more rooted in the character.
And in reading the full script, did you have a sense that this character, in really just a few scenes of the movie, would have the impact, even in that limited way? I mean, she is kind of the object of the movie, in a way, for Joaquin's character. But, you know, she is the driving force, and yet she doesn't appear till more than halfway through the movie.
Yeah.
And then is only there a few times.
Yeah.
Did you have a sense that that would be great, that that would have that kind of impact?
Impact on who?
The audience. Or are you not thinking about the audience?
Yeah. I mean, it occurred to me after we wrapped, I had this sudden overwhelming fear. I just kept hearing it in my head, the first person to be bad in a Paul Thomas Anderson movie, you know? Like, I did have that kind of obsession for a while after we wrapped. But while we were working, I had enough to distract me, you know, with the character and trying to get it right. And I didn't think about the audience too much. I would have been a basket case. I was playing a girl from Southern California. I had to silence all of my New York neurotic tendencies for the duration of the shoot.
So in retrospect, do you think Paul would have let you be bad? You mean, you think that's an option there in that universe?
I don't even know how to measure that stuff. I can't even rate my own work at all. Even in this, it's really difficult to watch yourself and to, how the hell do you know, you know, and how effective you are when you're watching yourself. It's very strange. I don't know. I don't know. It's tough to talk about that.
So what was the first experience of seeing the movie for you?
Well, I saw early cuts last fall. Mm-hmm. It's just thrilling, you know. It's the work I had to do in the film was pretty heavy, but the rest of the film is such a joy to watch, and it's so much fun that I was nervous to watch it with a big audience at the New York Film Festival. And I thought I would just watch the first few scenes, and after the first few scenes, I thought, I'll just watch one more. And I gotta see this scene. Oh, Martin Short's coming, I wanna wait for that. You know, and like it kept going, and then the credits were rolling, you know, I couldn't take my eyes off it. I don't think there's anything else like it, and I'm grateful for that, just as an audience member.
So do you look away when it's you, or are you uncomfortable when it's you, or you got used to it finally?
It's tough to watch yourself, but you know, to not watch myself means I miss Joaquin's performance, and I don't want to do that, so
is it
choice.
Tough?
I had to watch.
You were being forced to watch by
willing to watch because I didn't want to miss him.
And is it harder because you're sprawled out all over the movie to watch yourself, or is that even something are you watching the performance and not the nudity?
Well, I know what I look like naked, so it's not like it's a shock or a surprise to me.
You don't have a mirror in your bathroom, so.
That's true, but no.
So that wasn't uncomfortable at all for you? That's not an issue in your universe?
No.
Good, that's fine. I'm not judging, I'm just trying to.
No, I know, it's just funny. People. I people are asking me about that scene, what it was like to shoot it and stuff, and of course, I am aware that I am not wearing any clothes in that scene. But the scene is so interesting to me and so complicated and about so much more than that. And I guess that, coupled with the fact that I know what I look like naked, I tend to be more interested in the other things that are going on there between the two characters.
Well, it is a great power play sequence.
It's a really complicated scene.
Yeah.
I think it's so brilliantly written. So, you know, just about couples and intimacy and a lot of tricky stuff is in there.
So is there more of detail in the book than there was in the script in terms of the character and what that relationship was? Or is that something that you guys built?
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely more in the book. And the funny thing about just having a book, having that kind of source material, is that even just a word can be so helpful. There's a line in the book about what the Manson murders, the effect the Manson murders had on Shasta and her friends and their community, you know, young actresses. And I mean, first of all, just her friends, just the mention of her friends, that just every kind of like every little word can set you off down a sort of rabbit hole of exploration. Well, who are these people? What's that about? But also it said something like the Manson murders, it was upsetting for people everywhere, mm-hmm. but the effect it had on Chasta and her friends was paralyzing. Mm-hmm. You know, so you just get this word and it gives you so much about the character and what she's feeling or going through or might be going through, and you dig around in there, and it's really fun to have that kind of source material, you know. But yeah, in terms of that particular scene, sure, there was more.
I mean, that's part of the thing about the movie, I think, is all the characters are so rich.
Yeah.
That it's like each one of them is like their own pudding flavor.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
You know, even
I think
for
all
a minute.
Of Paul's films, he writes rich characters, you know, even for supporting roles, and Pynchon does the same thing. You get these, you know, these efficient little descriptions of people in the book, and you with only a few pages you really know who that guy is, and so they're so well suited to one another because they both really know how to show someone a complete character in a little bit of time. And I feel like in this movie it's just scene after scene you get invited into another world, or you get exposed to another person and you know them, you know, you really, it's not just like a wash, you know, you really get like that particular weirdo and this particular nut, you know, it's a treat.
So now you've done it, now you've worked with Paul and you're getting all this love.
And now my life is ruined and the bar is so fucking high. And he, yeah, I know, I joke, he made my dreams come true and ruined my life in one fell swoop, because it's just, there's no one like him.
Mm. But you'll be happy to go on to the next.
Work. Yeah, sure. No, there are other people who are brilliant as well, and I'd like to work with them. Yeah, no.
And does all the love you've been getting and the response to the film impact you, or are you to kind of stay out of that headspace?
No, it's so, I mean, I don't read the reviews or anything, but I... a friend said to my dad once, you don't need to read the reviews, because if they're bad, your friends will tell you. Which is certainly true, but has been true in my life. But it's also true that you do hear when people say nice things. And well, I've been at this a long time, and I haven't made up for all the rejection and abuse I've gotten over the years yet. You know, all the nice things that have been said about this don't come close to how much negative crap I've been through. So I'm taking it and I welcome it. It's nice. But it's an icing on the cake thing. The day he told me I got the job, that was the good day. Mm. You know?
Better than the work?
No. But I mean, if I were to compare it to what the gift is, like the gift is the work, yeah, sure, getting the job, getting to do the job. Not some nice comment after, but it is a bloody relief. For sure.
Excellent. Thank you. Don't lean the shot. It's a bad idea.
Cutting.